Hi everyone. I hope everyone is doing fine. Today we are going to discuss a sector which is extremely dear to our heart and for various reasons. This is a sector which is a big contributor to India's GDP and its contribution to GDP has been steadily rising. This is a sector where it has made inroads in exports and it's been the flag bearer of India's reputation worldwide. This is a sector which is one of the biggest employer as far as organized employment is concerned. And this is a sector which we use as example whenever we give examples of wealth creation, because there is somebody who invested 10,000 in some stock somewhere and is sitting on 500 crore or 600 crores. And there are numerous stories like that. I think you would have guessed it by now. Today we are going to discuss information technology and telecom. So subject matter expert we have today is Shibani Sirkar Kurian. She needs no introduction, but journey of around 20 years in capital market. She has worked across companies, across roles, and has been a pioneer as far as research is concerned in Kotak Mutual Fund. She's a fund manager, head equity research at Kotak Mutual Fund, and it's a pleasure for us to host her today. Welcome, Shivani, and hope you and your family and everyone at Kotak Mutual Fund is fine and staying safe.
Hi, thank you so much for having me with you. It's a pleasure to be here. These are extremely challenging times. And of course, the reliance on technology is increasing day by day. And so that brings us to a different paradigm shift where technology is concerned. And India is no different from the rest of the world. So it's a pleasure to be here, and especially talking about the technology and the telecom sectors.
Thanks, Shivani. Pleasure is ours. So Shivani, I'll set the context. We would have first few questions on information technology, and then we would move to telecom. So when we're discussing information technology, I agree that it's very difficult to cover this subject in 15, 20 minutes that we would want to delve on this. But to get your perspective, maybe there are one or two key questions which we have, and those questions can be added with a broader framework which you would have in mind. So my first question is that, you know, we have had wealth creation in this sector in India in last three and a half decades. But if we look at the latest round of wealth creation, which is happening in this sector worldwide, it is by innovators. While Indian companies are not known for innovation. So my first question would be to understand the innovation part of Indian companies. Second would be on the COVID. I've been seeing that, you know, stock market has been much more rewarding for this sector since the time of COVID outbreak. And there is a perception in the market that this sector would gain out of this crisis. Are we really in a position to take advantage of this, or are we reading too much into this? So if you can give us an idea about the broader IT services and IT sector in India, along with these two questions, that will help us understand and set the context right.
Right. So let me just start, talking about how the IT sector itself is evolving. You touched upon innovation, and that's the crux of the IT sector worldwide. And Indian IT companies, though service providers, are also no different. And also talk about the impact of COVID and how the opportunity is for Indian service providers today. So if you look at the flourishing IT ecosystem in India over the past 20, 25 years, that has overall been predicated by large scale availability of competent engineers. On the other hand, if you look at the US system, clearly innovation has been fostered by large scale availability of capital, both primary as well as secondary. And investors willing to back fledgling companies for outsized returns over a period of time. So it's not just in India, but even in places like, say, Europe and Japan, you've seen that the emergence of global tech leaders like what we have seen in the US, that's not really come about in the last, say, decade or so. So clearly the US has been at a forefront where innovation has been concerned, and that has been backed by capital, which has been willing to invest in terms of supporting some of these fledgling companies. However, at the margin, things are clearly changing in the overall global map. If you look at the way things are on the ground, especially for Indian, in India, startups are at the margin starting to attract capital, and venture capital is flowing through. And this presents an opportunity for IT services, scalable internet stories to emerge. Now, of course, in India, the difference between what it is for the US is that a lot of these companies are not there in the listed space as of yet. And therefore, we do have companies in the internet commerce space, which are attracting a lot of capital, but they are clearly not listed. And therefore, the question is Indian IT service providers, which are part of the listed universe really falling behind. However, if you look at the global industry on IT services, trends are evolving and growing. So even for the listed Indian service providers, there is a huge opportunity that is emerging. The emphasis on digital spending as part of the overall IT spending has been increasing. And today, digital has become part of the core. So it's no longer just trying to build the front end or just customer experience. It is essentially focusing on transformation of the core that is resulting in spends on IT services across the globe. So whether it be a company within the banking space, whether it be a company in the retail space, whether it be a telecom company, everybody wants to ensure that you are embracing technology and leading to transformation of the overall company and transformation of the core. So that's one big opportunity. The second opportunity, and if I may just, you know, to put in some figures, in fact, there was a recent study that was done by Gartner, which said that while FY21, because of COVID-related impact, FY21 could see a slight decline as far as discretionary IT spending is concerned. But between the period 2020 to 24, overall IT spending globally is expected to grow at a CAGR of almost 6.6%. And within that, they are saying that IT spending, especially if you look at in terms of services spending, that is expected to grow at a CAGR of almost 7.3%. So what they are really saying is that there is still a greater opportunity for IT services to grow at a faster pace. Now, so the question that really comes through is, where is this spend happening and what are the opportunities? So let's split it up into three parts. One is IT services. Second is enterprise software. And third is R&D or engineering R&D. So these are three broad areas that I'll really talk about. Now, within these three broad areas, there are some key trends that are emerging that are really important and actually really interesting where the IT services space is concerned. The first is the automation and AI. Clearly, as you know, every company is focused today in a post-COVID environment in terms of automating cost cutting and therefore increasing productivity. And therefore, automation and AI together is becoming a large and integral part of IT spends of companies worldwide. So whether it be smartphones, content platforms, online shopping, the focus has been on using automation as well as artificial intelligence into providing better customer experience as well as improving productivity. So that's one key area. The second area of spend is on data management, especially with migration to the cloud. Now, if you look at what was happening maybe a couple of decades ago when the entire IT industry started evolving, data management centers were these large scale centers where you had huge amount of hardware and therefore requiring a lot of maintenance, a lot of space, etc. Today, everything is migrating to the cloud. Now, there are three types of cloud migration that is happening. One is to private cloud, one is to public cloud, and the third is hybrid. Now, because of security concerns, a lot of people and a lot of companies are focusing on cloud migration, but they want to move either to a private cloud or to a hybrid cloud structure. Whether you move to whatever cloud structure, the service opportunities that revolve around cloud migration are significant. So it's cloud migration, consulting, application modernization, all of this is resulting in opportunities for the Indian service provider. The third is the digital transformation that I started my piece with. So clearly, businesses are rewiring themselves to operate in a new age. So you need to reimagine your entire supply chain. Initially, when digital started, it was very consulting heavy. So you focused only on the front end. So you wanted to integrate your front end, provide a better customer experience. Today, there is a need to integrate not just the front end, but also the back end, as well as the mid office. And so it's a full on integration at the company level, which is what is also happening from a digital transformation perspective. So that is another key area that is emerging from an IT services space. And finally, at the center of all this is Internet of Things. So IoT is at the center, software as a service is at the center and at the core of this digital transformation journey that most of the companies around the world across verticals are really engaging on. So what this all this means is that today IT services players in India need to innovate. They need to look at product innovation, service innovation. Essentially, they need to work with the customer to provide an enhanced customer experience, help them improve productivity as well as to ensure that they are able to improve their entire operations and their enterprises. The other areas that are, because of COVID especially, as you know, that work from home has become quite the norm. And a lot of companies are evaluating whether on a long-term structural basis, you would need to work from home. And therefore, workplace modernization is also something that most companies are really taking up. So there was an earlier belief that especially in projects where there was a lot of client interface, where you were working at the client site, there was a problem because you didn't want the IT service provider and their workforce to work from home because there was a fear of data security. So essentially at the crux of it, as you are more and more becoming open to the concept of work from home, you are ensuring that data security, overall workplace modernization, all of that becomes integral in your approach to IT services. So that is clearly another segment where cybersecurity, as I said, workplace modernization, these are some of the areas where there is a lot of innovation. So as a result of which, what I'm trying to say is that while Indian IT service players are derivatives of the demand opportunity that is brought on by the innovation that you've seen globally in some of these US global tech giants, but the opportunity for Indian service providers are immense in that sense, because the technology spend of companies across the globe, across verticals, whether it be, you know, companies like, say, Microsoft, Apple, Amazon, or even banks, or even retailers. While retailers, for example, are the most impacted because of COVID, they themselves believe that they need to transform to more of an online model rather than an offline model that requires IT spend. So all of this means that they want to integrate their businesses, and technology is at the core of it. And therefore, digital transformation during this COVID period has been enhanced, and that provides a greater opportunity to the Indian players. And before I end, all I will say is that Indian IT services players are well placed in this environment because they have spent a fair degree of time over and investments over the last, say, 2-3 year period in terms of reskilling their people. And as a result of which, today, if you look at India, India is a pool of talent for this digital transformation journey. And most of the companies are looking to outsource to countries like India, specifically India. And therefore, India is well placed from an overall opportunity perspective to grab a part of this huge market share.
Thanks, Shivani, for a very, very detailed response. And, you know, it set the context very right. And it gave us an idea on how IT services sector is placed in India. But I would just go back to your answer. And, you know, you mentioned a few terms, which is about backing of capital, companies not being listed in India, which are in the startup phase, and you know, a lot of focus being on IoT, a lot of focus being on cloud, data management, technological changing, technologies, and digital transformation. Now we see a lot of startups which have done extremely well in that space. We have seen, you know, everyone from Japanese companies to Chinese companies to American companies investing in those ideas. But when it comes to listing of those companies, we hardly see any company getting listed.
Yeah.
It's not the case worldwide, because you have companies in US which have got listed, and there is a good frequency at which they keep on getting listed. Is it because the valuation model which Indian fund managers or Indian equity analysts or equity researchers are using are very rudimentary and the valuation is an issue? Or is there some other reason that we are not getting the IPOs of these companies at a pace and at a frequency which we would want to see?
So you are right. There is a divergence in terms of valuations of tech startups. And this is not a phenomena which is specific only to, say, a particular country. This is a phenomena that has been seen across the world. And this is essentially an outcome of the demand-supply dynamics of the venture capital universe that really feeds into funding these sort of investments. Now, you know, in India, clearly, one is that, as I mentioned, there are a number of startups that have received funding. And it is possible that over a period of time, as these startups mature, they will come to listing in the public space. Remember, once you get listed in the public space, there is a lot more demand that comes from the shareholder perspective, because a lot of it is now in the public domain. And therefore, for you to be listed, you need to have a slightly mature business model, which will help you cater to the requirements of a listed entity. So for instance, in case of a normal listed entity, you will have to declare quarterly numbers, for instance. You will have to talk to a number of analysts, both buy side as well as sell side. You will have to talk a lot more about your business model, give out a lot more details, which you may not want to do at the nascent stages of some business operations. So you possibly, and as long as capital is available to you in form of private capital or venture capital, you will seek to use that capital first in terms of reaching a stage in your business, which is towards maturity. And then once you reach there, then you will tap the public markets for capital. So that's the way we believe that it is possible. That one is that in US, you've seen the outcome where some of these listings have been very rewarding from an investor perspective. And therefore, there is a lot of interest that has been generated. And therefore, it is possible that when you look at some of the Indian startups, in that context, over the next few years, my expectation is that there would be a number of them who would contemplate IPOs. And as and when their businesses start to reach the stage where they are okay with going public, they will possibly go public. So I think the overall ecosystem for technology companies, let's not just say IT services, but technology companies will change in terms of the listed entities over the next couple of years. Clearly, it's maybe just a matter of time when these companies come for listing. And like I said, when you are a listed entity, it brings you need to contend with a lot more things that you don't normally need to contend with. And, as a startup, you are answerable only to your private capital provider, right? I mean, but as a listed entity, you are answerable to number of shareholders, and all of that brings a different set of skill sets that you need to bring to the table as well. So it takes a little bit of evolution, and therefore, once that happens, you will start seeing some of these IPOs coming to the table as well. And my belief is that over the next few years, you will see a lot more technology companies coming. Today in the Indian listed space, there are hardly any such players. There may be one or two, but nothing like the large ones that you have seen in the US.
In fact, we also subscribe to that view because we also wish these companies to get listed, because that will bring for fresh perspective to capital market as well, and which is very much required in a market like India. So Shibani, my next question is about the structure of this industry. So, one good thing about this industry is that most of the big players are sitting on huge amount of cash, and they have been sitting on that cash for a good number of years now. And we also see this industry and this sector, like other sector, also being polarized, where big are becoming bigger. But we don't see much of a mergers and acquisition in this space like we see in some other sectors. So on one hand, you have big companies. On other hand, they have huge amount of cash. But when it comes to acquisition, they end up doing acquisition, which is very, very small in comparison to the overall appetite they have. So what do you think is the reason? And do you think this trend will change and we would see a lot of mergers acquisition happening in this space?
Yeah, so when an IT company looks for acquisition, clearly they are looking to add to their capabilities, right? So you are looking at areas where there is possibly a gap from a capability perspective, and you want to add to that capability. Now, when you're talking about the mid-cap and the large-cap IT players, so while you correctly mentioned that IT as a sector is a huge cash-generating sector, and therefore all large IT players sit with a huge amount of cash on their balance sheets because they are throwing up free cash every year. And therefore, why is that cash not being used for making large-scale acquisitions? Now, the point is that if you want to make an acquisition of a mid-cap company or a small company, which essentially provides or caters or works in the same verticals that you work, that company really doesn't bring anything much to the table. So as a result of which, there is a significant overlap of capabilities between what the large cap companies do and what some of the mid-tier or the smaller IT services companies do. So if you look at the model that, for instance, Accenture follows a model of acquiring a number of companies. And these companies are essentially smaller companies which bring digital capabilities to the fore. And as a result of which, while the number of acquisitions a company like Accenture does, it is essentially focused on smaller companies which are, in some segment of digital technology which they acquire. Indian companies have also been following a similar route. So if you look at companies, they do make acquisitions. However, the number of acquisitions may be lower. And also the kind of acquisitions that are made by these companies are that of bringing capabilities which they may not have, or the plugging a hole in terms of their overall capabilities. And so these are essentially small companies, may not be in the listed space, which they bring about. However, what we are also seeing is that in a way, consolidation is really playing out in the industry. Now, why I say so, and maybe in the COVID context, consolidation in some form or the other will play out further, and therefore companies will look at focusing on building scale. And you've seen one such instance where there has been an acquisition of a mid-tier IT company, and you know where we'll have to see how it works out. But it's possible that over the next couple of years there could be merger of those two companies, which you know you would know what I'm talking about. However, also what we are seeing is that in terms of the client base, now earlier a client would work with a tail of companies, so you would have a number of IT projects running at a client center where you will have the large companies participating in that pool, and you could have some of the smaller companies participating in that overall pool, deal pool as well. However, now because of COVID, what most companies are doing is that they want to bring about some degree of vendor consolidation. So they don't want to work with a large tail of vendors. So they want to work with maybe the top 2-3 players and have a smaller pool of vendors who are working with, who they are working with. And therefore, overall vendor consolidation means that the larger players, or even within the mid-cap space, those who bring specific capabilities to the table will win projects, or will see that some of the competition actually moving away. So in that sense, there will be some degree of consolidation happening in terms of winning part of that pie of projects that I spoke about. So if you look at deal wins, the large deal wins that have happened over the last 2-3 years, you will see that these large deal wins are concentrated between a few large players. So when there is, you know, negotiations happening or bidding for, or the RFP process, as we call it, for a deal, you will see that there is a clear distinction between what the larger players, or even within the mid-cap players or the mid-sized players, in terms of capabilities that they bring to the table. And post-COVID, we believe this whole trend of vendor consolidation is likely to accelerate. And in that sense, possibly the large companies could grow larger because they will win possibly a larger share of the deal pipeline that is there in the process.
Point well taken. You know, you made a very relevant point that, you know, mergers and acquisitions have to happen if there is a complementing skill set, if there is a client base and vendor consolidation strategy which is in place. So that brings me to the last question as far as IT is concerned, and then we'll move to telecom. And this is a very politically sensitive question, and it's about US. You know, and it's become all the more sensitive because we are, you know, a couple of months away from elections. So what we have seen time and again is that whenever there is a change in governance in US, and whenever there is an election time, Indian IT companies become the scapegoat, and there has been, you know, numerous instances of policy changes happening because of that. This time it's become all the more critical because of unemployment numbers which have shot up through the roof in US. So do you think it's a big threat to India and Indian IT companies, or do you think it's just an election agenda? And on the other hand, we also see Indian IT companies also preparing themselves very well by hiring a lot of local people in US. So how do you think this is going to change, and what is the outlook on that? Because the problem is the concentration of Indian IT services to US is extremely high, and more than 60% of our exports are in US. So this becomes very important for us to understand as a dimension to the entire sector.
You are absolutely right. You know, when you said that Indian IT companies have been preparing themselves for higher degree of protectionism for a period of time where the US is concerned. Of course, this, as you mentioned correctly, being an election year and also a year where there has been an impact on economy, the noise around protectionism has been far more than what it has been over the last few years. However, where the US is concerned, IT companies have realized that they clearly need to build more capabilities where, you know, in terms of on-site presence. So whether it be in terms of hiring on-site directly from the campuses in the US, also in terms of setting up data centers in the US, not just this year, but over the last maybe 2-3 year period. So therefore, if you look at the number of visa applications where Indian IT services companies are concerned, while they still constitute a majority of the H-1B visa applications, for instance, in absolute numbers, that number has actually been coming down, because they have been over the last couple of years hiring their requirements from the local talent pool available in the US as a start. So there has been a lot of investments that have already gone in terms of building the on-site presence. And therefore, as the elections get over, by the end of the year, possibly the noise and the rhetoric around protectionism will also come down a bit. But remember, in this post-COVID world, everywhere there will be some degree of protectionism that will come, because finally what has happened is economies have been hit quite badly, and therefore there will be this whole noise always because of the need to protect jobs where your own citizens are concerned. But also remember, COVID brings another huge opportunity because companies themselves want to cut costs, and therefore they are also looking at ways to reduce costs and to become more efficient. And therefore outsourcing as a theme can actually pick up where IT services are concerned. And here work from home has demonstrated that even in case of front-end projects, for instance, where there is a huge digital content, where typically the employee of the Indian firm would be sitting at the client office, today that employee is working from home, right? Or the employee has come back to India, for instance. And therefore, the client realizes that it is not necessary to have an on-site presence always to be able to deliver projects on time. And in fact, the great part has been that despite all these disruptions initially because of supply-led issues, all IT services players have been able to deliver on projects pretty much on time. And the second thing is that deal wins have been continuing. So if you look at the pace of deal wins, especially some of the large deal wins, even in the time of COVID, they have been able to win deals. And therefore, this shows that work from home is changing the dynamics where IT and outsourcing as a concept is. So yes, we will have to possibly contend with the noise around protectionism, but then there are workarounds, and overall IT services players have been preparing themselves for it for a period of time. And increasing outsourcing actually presents an opportunity over a structural 1 to 2 year period, where you can actually see improvement in deal flows rather than, lower deal flows because of the protectionism angle.
That's very well said, Shivani. And, you mentioned a few terms in your response, which are not generally associated with Indian companies, like finishing projects on time, healthy deal win, and, having capability, which is improving with each passing day. And this is very heartening to hear. So from IT, we move to telecom. And so my first question in telecom, which everyone would generally ask you, is about a duopoly structure, which we have created in India in last couple of years. So my broader question is that there are three entities which are there in Indian telecom space. One is public sector entities, which are not spending too much resources, and they are not growing at a level at which they were earlier envisaged to grow. Then you have healthy set of companies which are doing fairly well. And then you have a third set of one company which is struggling because of various reasons. So do you think with the kind of telecom reach we need in India, with the kind of telecom growth that we are anticipating in a country like ours, with the demography supporting, but on the other hand, geography being very, very widespread, are we at the right place with the right structure in India, with the way it has been created by default, by regulator or whatever reason? Or is there a reason for us to get worried and think about how to rectify this?
Yeah, so you're right. The Indian telecom services industry has evolved, and it has essentially become a duopoly rather. And if you look at the top two players, they have expanded their coverage to more than 90% of their population. Now, from a market our size, typically three or four healthy players would be ideal for quick and efficient rollout of networks, for instance. However, in some cases, the key concern is that would duopoly lead to slower rollout of new technologies like 5G, for instance, going forward? And would there be an impact because of this? However, if you look at the top two players, which are the dominant players in the telecom space, both of these players are well funded and they are striving to improve their market share and possibly remain the network of choice. And they have, as I mentioned, already expanded their coverage to almost 90% plus of the population. So what is also changing, from an Indian telecom industry perspective is that these two players were clearly focused on gaining market share for the last, say, 3-4 years. But now they have arrived at a point in time when the market share gains are now behind them because they have managed to achieve what they started out with. So it's no longer a focus on just market share, but a focus on profitability. And that is what is key where the telecom players are today concerned. There is a visible trend that is, we can see in terms of improvement on profitability, bringing down balance sheet leverage, And as you know that, you know, the largest player, for instance, has gone through a number of funding instances in the last, in the recent past. So from that perspective, the fear that the duopoly will lead to an impact from a service provider or from a client perspective, that is, I think, pretty, it's on the lower side, because from an overall ability to service the customer base and also to bring new technologies and ensure that rollout of, say, for instance, the 5G network is happening on time, I think these two players are pretty well placed at this point in time. And any which ways, the third provider, in terms of ability to access money or capital, it was significantly dented. They had a huge amount of leverage also on their balance sheet. And for them to operate profitably was not possible. And therefore, with the exit or, you know, marginalization of the third player, the top two players have now concentrated their efforts on improving profitability, which is good from a sector perspective, rather than the market share price wars that was taking place over the last 3-year period.
So toward the end of last response, you mentioned something called improving profitability, and my next question is pertaining to that. So yeah. You also mentioned adequately capitalized, an exercise to deleverage. But if we look at how it has been panning out, thanks to I would say some kind of a cartelization or push from the government that last year, and these guys decided not to get into the tariff war any further and increase the prices and increase the tariffs. However, we haven't seen the improvement in ARPU in sync with what was increased, 6 to 7 months back. So my question is that, are we in a perpetual cycle of hoping to see these companies turning profitable, or would we see profit coming to these companies in a healthy way in near future?
You are absolutely right. There was this last round of tariff hikes that happened in December 2019. However, while it led to some improvement in ARPUs, it did not reflect to the extent of the tariff hikes. Also, these companies were planning to take another round of tariff hikes sometime in March, April. But as you know, COVID struck, and as a result of which they had to postpone their tariff hikes. And it is possible during the rest of the year, as we come back to a normalized level of demand and growth, these companies will resume taking their tariff hikes. Also, what happened in case of the largest player today, that while they took a tariff hike, what happened is their customer mix changed a bit, because there was a change in subscriber mix incrementally towards the lower ARPU Jio, if I may say so, Jio phone customer profile. And as a result of which, while there was a headline tariff hike, because of the change of the subscriber mix at the margin, it did not reflect as much in terms of ARPUs, as you correctly mentioned. However, what is clearly happening is that the current level of tariffs and the current level of ARPUs that these telecom companies are generating is not enough for them to deliver double-digit return on capital employed. So they realize that for them to reach profitable, healthy levels of return ratios, they would have to keep on increasing their tariffs. And that is something that has been reflected in some of the commentary from the managements of these companies as well, that these tariff hikes are here to stay and there is actually no other alternative for the long-term health of the sector. So as I mentioned, while they were likely to have taken a tariff hike maybe in March, April, but because of COVID, that got postponed. And it is likely that as we come back to some degree of normalcy, economic activity starts to improve, these tariff hikes will also happen. I think it's very clear that the management focus of these top two service providers has shifted away from market share, because there's no more market share to be really gained at this point in time. And you now have to run a profitable venture, and as a result of which, balance sheet deleveraging and improving return on capital employed are the two key areas of focus. And that would mean that tariff hikes are here to stay, and you will possibly see that happening over the course of the year.
Though it might not sound too good for the users of these services, but yes, but I agree with you that in fact, this week itself there was a statement from Mr. Mittal that these tariff hikes are here to stay and it is unsustainable to work at these prices. So my next question is about the broader structure of the sector, how it has been for last few years. There have been government intervention, there have been regulatory interventions, there have been judicial interventions. This sector was supposed to be the brilliant and the best sector in India, you know, in last decade or for decades to come. So, you know, had we spoken to fund managers or analysts in 2010, they would have said, blindly put your money on telecom and it'll give you rewarding returns. But what we have seen is instead of getting rewarding returns, which we have got in a couple of ideas, most of these companies have either gone out of business or they are not to be seen. So my question is that despite having so much of stress in the sector, you have one company attracting so much of capital, which we have seen, and that too in lockdown. The kind of money which India couldn't get, this single company has got in last 3 to 4 months. So the bigger question is that do we need policy changes at this point of time for us to have continuous flow of FDI and you know, big mergers and acquisition in this sector, not only for one company, but for a broader set of companies, and maybe in order to create an ecosystem of future where we have multiple players playing on multiple skill sets and multiple niches rather than having one player taking it all kind of a, you know, scenario, which we are right now expecting to happen in India.
So let me answer it in two parts. So let me talk about the regulatory impact in terms of that impact on profitability. And let me also answer it in terms of the need to have multiple players and whether that is necessary for the growth of the sector. Now, answering the second part first, if you look at consolidation, essentially consolidation has been playing out in many sectors and telecom has been a prime example of it. Across all sectors where there is consolidation, what is clearly visible is pricing power, and pricing power brings profitability back. When there is excess competition, number of players are high, there are number of new entrants, all of that results in dilution of pricing power, and as a result of which, profitability of the sector gets impacted. Now, telecom is a highly regulated sector, right? So, and it requires a lot of capital to come in, requires a lot of investments, and therefore, it is not possible or not very easy for a new entrant at this point in time to really come into the market, because of the investments that are required and also because of the regulatory hurdles. And therefore, it is possible that this market really stays concentrated between the top two players. I don't think necessarily that's a bad thing, because really, from a company perspective, one may argue that whether for a customer it results in, you know, in terms of reduction of choice of service providers, possibly yes. But from a company perspective, and if you look at it from an investment perspective, it results in creating of an environment where there is a healthy level of competition, but there's also rationality in pricing. So if you look back between in what happened over the last, say, 5 to 6 year period or over the last decade in telecom, now regulatory action clearly has impacted the balance sheet in terms of laying spectrum charges, license fees relating to past periods and the like. And some of that impact is still being seen, and right, and it's still being, you know, we've still not come to a conclusion. However, what has impacted the industry more than the regulatory action has been irrational pricing. And it is because of this irrational pricing and sharp drop in terms of pricing where both data as well as where voice is concerned, that the balance sheet and profitability and the ability to actually continue as a going concern for some of these service providers has become an issue. So it's, while regulatory environment has also created hurdles, it has been more the irrational pricing and irrational competition that has hurt the players more. And some of the players which did not have deep pockets or deep balance sheets, they are the ones that got wiped out. And I think now there is sanity returning to the industry. And I think that's good from an industry perspective. And for the long-term health of the industry, you need this sort of pricing sanity to come through so that you are able to flourish. And without the improvement in ARPUs, India as a country, as you know, that we are, you know, in terms of the number of service subscribers that we have, we are possibly among the largest in the world. But the fact is that it has to be a profitable subscriber base for the companies to continue. And today we are at a situation where that is a reality and looks like a reality, at least for the time to come.
Shivani, that's an extremely comforting answer, and we really hope that to happen, because you know, this is the backbone for everything else that we would end up doing, including the business which we do and the business which maybe you do. It might have far-reaching impact. So that brings me to the last question of our discussion, and I'm really apologetic, Shivani, because whenever we discuss about telecom, we are so engrossed in the past that we don't look at the future. So one last question from my side on the future, and which is 5G. Now, there are multiple variables to 5G. On one hand, Indian government is cash-strapped and it needs to auction 5G in order to get some cash on its books. on the other hand, you have one player who is extremely interested, while the other player is showing reluctance in terms of the pricing which 5G might have in terms of spectrum pricing. And then you have Supreme Court, which has got involved now into spectrum issues of the past. And then lastly, this Huawei and China and US-China equation. So how do you see 5G panning out? And we had really high hopes from 5G. We still have. But do you think it's going to be impacted because of all these developments? Because on one hand, we had Reliance Jio announcing in the AGM that they are very well ready for 5G. But on the other hand, we have a lot of other issues which are still to be sorted out. So what's your take on 5G?
You are right, 5G rollout has been delayed a bit, but if you look at the commentary from most of the giant telecom companies, including the ones in India, the capital expenditure set out for rollout of 5G, those numbers remain unchanged. So what that shows is that the plan to roll out 5G has been delayed, but it has not been shelved. Therefore, we expect that the 5G rollout will happen over the next maybe 1.5, 2 year period. And because of COVID also, there has been a delay in terms of overall rollout, but it will happen over a period of time. So in fact, whenever we speak to any of the telecom providers or even some of the global companies, nobody has really talked about cutting back on capital expenditure where 5G is concerned. So the rollout will happen over a period of time. Now, what they are doing at this point in time is that what they are really concentrating, the current focus is essentially on setting up and or investing in terms of the setting up the network. And as a result of which, a lot of investments at this point in time is going in terms of one is acquiring spectrum and the second is in terms of setting up the network required for the 5G rollout. Now, in terms of the question as to whether, you know, because of this whole issue of Huawei, can there be a problem in terms of equipment providers? The answer to that, in my view, is no, because there are other equipment providers who can actually help. And therefore, while Huawei is a dominant player, it's not critical for the overall 5G rollout. So you do have other players and equipment providers like, say, Samsung, for instance, Nokia, Siemens, Ericsson, who can provide 5G solutions. Adoption on 5G in India, for instance, will still take some degree of time. Like I mentioned, maybe the rollout will start over the next couple of years. Asian countries like, say, Korea, South Korea, for instance, Japan, they are clearly ahead where 5G implementation is concerned. Across the globe, even you know, in the US or even in Europe, the 5G rollout has still not happened. So these small countries or small pockets in Asia, they are ahead of the curve. In India, I think it will take a couple of years. Globally, this can be a huge, you know, and as we were talking earlier about IT services, the 5G rollout from a telecom vertical perspective can be another large spend for clients and therefore beneficial for some of the Indian companies which have presence, especially where telecom is concerned. So let me end there.
That's very heartening again, because, you know, that's something which we desperately want at this point of time. So with this, we come to the end of our discussion, Shibani, and really a very thought-provoking discussion. We learned a few good things, you know, about sectors for which we were a little gloomy, and we learned a few good things about the sector which we were anyways bullish about. But I must say that, you know, we have had multiple sectors analysts guiding us on the sector's prospect going forward, but it's only pharmaceutical and IT stroke telecom where we have seen so many positive words being used by the expert, and that gives us a lot of confidence, and which is very rare in these times when it's only gloom doom everywhere. And really thankful to you for elevating our spirits a bit and giving us a lot of rays of hope. So I'm sure that, you know, we will, you know, as a country, be doing extremely well in both these sectors going forward. Thanks once again, Shibani, for taking out time on a busy day. And thanks for giving us an opportunity to interact with you and understand from you different elements of IT and telecom, which generally we would not get clearer answers about. And you were quite lucid and clear in your responses. Thank you so much. And I'm very sure that our investors would learn a lot from this